Welcome to The Culture Edit, unique perspectives into the personal and professional lives of individuals at the helm of successful business, athletics, art, and design. Welcome to The Culture Edit, episode 19. I'm here with my co-host. Say hello.
Hello. You haven't let me say hello in like 12 episodes,
well,
so
I
quit doing it.
I want to let you say hello today because it's a very special day for you.
Oh, okay.
Tell the people what you did today.
Rode a bicycle outside.
For the first time?
Yeah, for the first time in 7 weeks.
Probably like one of the longest you've ever gone without riding outside.
Outside of breaking my hip and having a heart attack, that would be the third longest, yeah.
So basically every 5 years you have an episode.
Exactly.
Okay.
You know what's funny is today I got a five-year reminder on Strava, how it does that now, like Instagram, like mm-hmm. 5 years ago. It was me riding again after pericarditis. Huh. And I just like rode with you and Warnicki to like, I don't know.
Like the mountain.
Yeah, not even to the mountain and back.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Isn't that crazy?
I miss Warnicki.
He's listening. We're going to start doing Warnicki check-ins.
I just got really sad. Move back.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, that was 5 years ago. So yeah, this was a long period. I still can't straighten my arm, but it's straight enough that I can ride.
Hutch is helping with that by pulling you really hard while you walk him on the leash.
He's trying
to straighten your arm out.
That's my rehab, is I let Hutch pull as hard as he can to straighten my arm out.
It's kind of like one of those medieval torture thing where you attach it to all your limbs and then I crank it up and it like pulls you in all different directions.
That's what Alan actually wanted to do.
Oh, why don't we do that?
Because it looks crazy. Like it's so that the contraption looks insane. I would be walking down the Beltline, everyone would be like, oh my God, what happened to that guy? Like it looks really.
But it's sweater weather. You could just put a sweater over it.
No, it's too big. You could not fit anything over it. Not anything I own.
The style is oversized jackets now, so.
Yeah.
You might have to actually
get some of Michael's clothes and wear it.
Baggy jeans, baggy shirts.
I started using a 3-pound egg weight, if you know what that is. They're used for boxing. And so I just carry that around, and that's like I always have it in my hand or when I'm sitting at a desk.
Yeah.
And that's helped a lot.
But today was a great day, beautiful weather. I woke up and ran and then came home. We got on the bike and we rode out to Stone Mountain, did a lap and came back, and it was really nice.
Beautiful. Beautiful Saturday. A rare Saturday for us.
Yeah. Yeah. It was really, really nice. And then hopefully maybe we'll ride tomorrow too. 2 days in a row. It'll be exciting.
I'm going to do airport long.
Just like ride off the front.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
I might add on some miles.
Another first is...
That's a joke, by the way.
Another first is that we had our first guest bail on us last minute, so we didn't have time to reschedule anyone else.
Yeah, that's why it's another one-on-one. But, you know, all the heads they say out there are kind of like the one-on-ones, so we're giving people what they want.
So, well, we do have a guest for next week. We're working with this guest to reschedule because I do think it'll be a really good episode.
It will. You know what? So we're starting to interview – sorry, we're starting to have guests that are also on podcasts. And the difference, I think, that we've run into is that no one is committed to the cadence that we are. Rain or shine, it's going to come out on Monday. Other than we know a couple of guys that have pretty popular podcasts that do it 3 times a week. We would never do that. But when you have that commitment to the cadence, then you just got to, if someone doesn't show, you just got to go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You made a rhyme.
I did. But she'll be worth it.
Yeah, for sure. And she is a good friend too, so I will be giving her a little bit of shit, but it'll be worth it because I think it'll be a really good episode.
For sure.
Another note is that I'm halfway to my half marathon.
Yeah.
So training's going really well. I thought that I had ruptured my Achilles on Monday by standing up and getting out of bed, and I basically was so panicked all week that I didn't tell Chad.
Yeah, I didn't know.
And so, because I heard a loud pop, and I immediately, and then I couldn't walk. And
then you're Aaron Rodgers?
Yes. And then, obviously. And then I start Googling, like, well, you know, can you strain your Achilles without, like hearing this loud pop, whatever. And everything was like, nope, you ruptured it. Like, you're done. So I took some anti-inflammatory medicine that I had saved, you know, like, stashed away.
She's a medicine saver.
For other purposes. And was like, well, if it makes, you know, inflammation in my knee go down, maybe it'll make the inflammation in my Achilles go down. I was hoping that it was Achilles tendonitis. And I think that's ultimately what it turned out to be because I'm totally fine now.
You ran the next day.
I did. Well, I had to continue to test my body. So I kept testing. So I like take medicine, like do my little like sauna blanket thing, then like stretch. And I just kept testing everything. And the first couple of times running, it was hurting. Luckily, this week was like a active recovery week. But today I actually did a decently quick 5 miles for quick for me, obviously not for others.
Yeah.
And I felt fine. So I think we're okay. I'm feeling good.
Good.
Yeah. I'm very excited.
It's around the corner.
And also I kind of did this thing, like, well, Chad's not surprised by it, where like all of a sudden I start fixing things. And so then I just like sign up for everything.
Yeah. You get so obsessed.
So I'm now signed up for the wait list to get into the Miami half marathon, which I really hope I get into because one, I want to see all of our friends in Miami. Two, it would be really fun to go down there and like ride and run. And three, it's obviously very flat. I looked at the course and it would be a really nice course. It goes like over to South Beach, then back around, then to Coconut Grove, and then back, I guess.
Hmm.
I think it starts and ends in Brickell. So it'd be fun. So I think November 7th, they let people know if you got off the wait list. And then I also, this is even bigger, I signed up for the Chicago Marathon.
You did?
I told you that.
No.
Yes, I did.
The marathon?
I sent you a message on Slack and said, hey, I just signed up.
For the marathon?
For the thing, yeah.
The full marathon.
Well, it's a lottery, so I'm not like in yet. They let us know also like November 7th, I think. Whether or not we got in the, like whether or not we got chosen.
Okay.
But that's next October. So, but I need these like really long term goals and I've never been to Chicago. So in my way of thinking, I was just like, this makes sense. Worst comes to worst, I can transfer my, I can transfer it to someone else. So yeah. It's not a big deal. But I'm very excited about it. So those are the two things that I have signed up for so far to keep me motivated. And I do think I'll be able to run and continue to ride together.
Yeah. I mean, one conflict is if I qualify for a Gravel Worlds.
Yeah. But it's...
You can't do them both at the same time.
Well, it would be like the following weekend. So I would just have to go, like we would get back from Worlds and then I guess fly to Chicago.
Okay.
But this is, we don't have to decide this right this second.
Yeah.
A lot can happen between then and now.
Welcome everyone to Chad and Nikki. Negotiating travel schedule next year.
I mean, I can go do the marathon myself. It's fine. I'm a self-sustaining lady.
It's true.
Maybe I can get Natalie to go with me.
Yeah, for sure.
That'd be fun. So this week, one thing that I went to that was really fun is I went to an event at Spanx, their headquarters in Buckhead. And I can't say what I went there for because I had to sign an NDA to do it. But it was real. I had never been in their headquarters. And it was a really, really, really cool place. I mean, the decorations obviously are very cool. Sarah really put a lot of like personality and personal touch into the space.
Sarah Blakely.
So they gave us like a little mini tour and the coolest thing is
fellow Florida State Seminole, by the way.
Yes. Go Noles.
Yeah.
When they're giving us a little tour, I guess Sarah had bid on, I don't know how long ago, but obviously not that long ago. Cause it was,
you sure this isn't covered by the NDA?
No, this is not covered by the NDA.
Okay.
It's in their office. Anyone can see it.
Okay.
It's literally like on display.
All right.
She bid on a Olivia Newton-John's original, like her black outfit from like the finale of Grease.
Better shake up. Shape up. Better shape up.
Better shape up. Cause I need a man. Oh. I pointed at Chad.
Yeah.
As I sang
and
that.
People are getting a little insight into your singing.
It's pretty terrible.
She can sing.
Anyways, bid on and won the original outfit.
Yeah.
From Grease. So I just thought that was really cool.
You posted a picture of it.
Yeah. I took a picture of it.
Yeah.
All
black with red heels. That's like your outfit.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. Yeah. It was a cool space. The event was really fun. I tried my first Paloma. I never had a Paloma. It's like a tequila drink. That was amazing.
Yeah.
And also...
I love that this was is that covered by the NDA? This is a work event. They were pouring tequila?
Yes.
Wow. Sounds like a cool place.
Yeah. It felt really cool.
Yeah.
I mean, all the employees really seemed to love it there.
Did any men work there?
I did see one guy.
Okay.
Like walking around.
Okay.
He looked very confused by us.
All right.
But yeah, mostly women, definitely mostly women. But it was an event at 6 p.m. So there was like no one in the office at that point.
Maybe for our international listeners, explain what Spanx is.
Well, Spanx is international. You can get it anywhere.
Okay.
But
maybe
for the men that don't
know.
Since
50% of our listeners are men, how about
if
that?
If you're
part?
A woman and you don't know what Spanx is, you've been living under a rock for your entire life.
Okay, but explain to the 50%
so for
of
men,
our audience.
It's just well, it started out as shapewear. So Sarah Blakely founded Spanx in the one bedroom of her tiny house that she lived in selling, I think that was like fax machines. and she started cutting her own shapewear because she was going door to door selling fax machines.
We have an audience watching us record. Sorry, go ahead.
Are they actually watching
us? Yeah, behind you.
How can they see through the thing? I think they can just see themselves.
Oh, maybe.
They're just looking at themselves, the reflection.
That happened to me the other day. I was walking Hutch and last night, and I saw a guy in the office space of one of the apartments by us. And I was like, why is that guy looking at me? It was me. Anyway, go ahead.
Wait, you saw your own reflection?
Yeah, I thought it was someone else. I was like, what was that weirdo looking at me? And then I moved and it was me.
That's...
Yeah.
We might need to get your eyes checked. So anyway, Spanx is shapewear. That's how it started out. But now it's more than that. It's clothing. It's workout. It's activewear. It's...
Like normal clothes, right?
Yeah, normal clothes. But all of the clothes are kind of based around being flattering. So like they have their jeans, but the jeans are like more stretchy. And like I don't have any pair of jeans, so I can't really speak to how they actually fit. But I do have a bunch of their leggings. And so they're all very, everything's supposed to be kind of form fitting, flattering, all that good stuff. But I've always loved the brand because I really like Sarah because she went to Florida State. And I'm just always been really inspired by her.
Yeah.
So it was for me personally, it was really cool just to, like, I felt like such a fangirl.
She invited us to go to the movies with her one time.
Yeah, that was... But she's such an introvert
yeah.
that I was kind of surprised. Like, actually, it's funny. Someone messaged me on Instagram and was like, oh, that's so cool. You went to Spanx headquarters. Like, did you meet Sarah? And I was like, well, she doesn't work there anymore. But I'm sure she still stops by. But I said, well, actually, I did meet her, weirdly, through friends at a movie, like a premiere one time, because she's friends with Reese Witherspoon. They're like, her and Reese Witherspoon, I guess, are really good friends.
Yeah.
So we all went to this premiere for Reese Witherspoon's movie. And she was such an introvert. It really surprised me. And she like basically didn't talk. Like I was trying to talk to her and she just like wouldn't talk to me.
Y'all sat by each other.
We sat right next to each other the whole time. Yeah. And like anyone listening to this that knows me knows I feel like I can talk to a tree.
Yeah.
She was giving nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing.
She was giving tree vibes.
She was giving like more than tree vibes.
It's very nice though.
Yeah. She's just really introverted. And now that I like see Jesse, her husband, posting more about her on his Insta, because I didn't follow him at the time. And he talks about all the time, like how much of an introvert she is. So I know it wasn't like a mean thing. It was just funny. Cause when you like meet someone who you idolize, you're like, oh my gosh, I want to just ask them questions and get to know them. But we sat in silence. Never meet your idols.
Your heroes. Yeah.
Your heroes. And no, I'm just kidding. I still...
It's not a great movie either.
She really motivates me.
Sorry, Reese.
And
I can't even remember what it was.
Pretty much every aspect of my life. So it was a fun event. What was even funnier is we were in a meeting room, and one of the women that was in the meeting room with me, we were going around kind of like introducing ourselves, and I said that I was a cyclist. Skip ahead like an hour, a bunch of the other women that work at Spanx are also cyclists, but they didn't disclose that at the time. And so I say I'm a cyclist, I ride or whatever. And the woman who goes to introduce herself after me immediately goes, I just want you to know my husband hates you, hates cyclists.
Wow.
We live in Buckhead and we hate you.
Wow.
So it started off the meeting kind of spicy.
Wow. And what did you say back to her?
I just like kind of looked at her and was like, I mean, at least people are outside being active. And
did she look like she's very active?
Yeah, but she like had never had a job. She literally didn't work and she just plays golf all day and like is like a Buckhead Betty.
Okay.
So it was just weird.
Buckhead Betty is a common term for those folks listening outside of Atlanta.
Yeah, I mean, she was a complete snob.
Yeah.
Like total snob. I'll never see this woman again. Actually, I probably
You don't think she's a listener?
I don't think she's a listener.
So I'm surprised you didn't like snap back.
Well, I think I said something along the lines of, wouldn't you rather have people that are passionate about a sport and spending their time exercising than like doing drugs?
Doing drugs? That's where you went?
That's what I always think about, because a cyclist...
Like, I would do drugs if I wasn't riding a bike. Well, Aren't you glad I'm riding a bike, lady?
Think of all... Exactly. Think of all the like kind of self-destructive personalities that are endurance athletes.
Okay.
Like, it's a very addictive thing. Like, if you are addicted to running or cycling or swimming, you could easily be addicted to something bad. I've always thought that. Yeah, but really at the end, once she found out that there was like half the room with cyclists in some way, shape, or form,
yeah,
I ended it with looking at her and I said, so if you could just tell your husband to please not run us over next time he sees us, that would be great.
Wow.
What'd she and say? It was so awkward, but everyone like low-key like smiled and kind of chuckled.
What did she respond?
She just like awkwardly stared at me and like, well, it was more of a glare, but I didn't care.
It's I think it's always a cool thing to have that conversation because it reminds people that those people on bikes are actually humans, like real humans.
Why did your husband hate us so much? Because she was like, when you're riding on Mount Perrin, he just can't stand it. I'm like, that is the snobbiest. Like if any...
The speed limit's like 25 miles an hour.
That's what I'm saying. Your husband and his... $200,000 Mercedes, like he can't just go around a cyclist at 25. We're probably going 20 miles an hour.
Yeah.
It's like the most ridiculous thing.
Phil Guymon has on his YouTube channel, if anyone's ever interested, he has such a great video about this topic, about having reasonable conversations about why you hate cyclists so much. It's so good.
Because they have no answer.
Yeah. There's no answer.
And again, she said her and her husband are both retired. Where are you rushing to down Mount Perrin that you can't just go around a cyclist?
Yeah.
The golf course.
It's bizarre. I've never understood it.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, she was a special character, but if you're from Atlanta, you're kind of used to those types of people anyway, so you're just like, whatever.
Are you done violating your NDA or are we moving on?
I didn't violate the NDA.
Okay.
I just couldn't say what I was there for or what I was doing. I never said what I was there for or what I was doing.
Okay. Can't wait for the letter.
Well, good thing you're a lawyer. I'm really excited as we... So we're recording this now. It's Saturday. This weekend is a really big weekend in Atlanta.
Festivus weekend is what
we
call it.
But I feel like we kind of failed as Inman Parkers because we didn't plan anything. Because
we're tired. We plan things all the time.
Well, that and... it kind of snuck up on it. I didn't realize how many festivals. So there's a historic Old Fourth Ward Skate Park Festival, which is literally outside of our house. Then there's the Little Five Points Festival, which is
Halloween festival.
Yeah, but there's the festival and then the parade tomorrow. But today's the festival.
But it's Halloween, yeah.
And then there is the Farmer's Market. And then there is the Inman Park Wine Stroll.
Yeah, the Wine Stroll
is huge. Which is basically a bunch of drunk people wandering down the middle of roads, hammered.
Yeah.
Taking scooters, busting their face open. It's quite the scene.
Yeah, for our friends that don't live here, so we live in probably one of the only walking neighborhoods, and it's a big destination for bars, restaurants, people partying and having fun. It's kind of like
the West Village, honestly.
West Village, Coconut Grove.
Yeah. What would be like Venice in LA?
Yeah.
Like that. Yeah, yeah. You know, Venice. That main. Yeah.
There's like 10 things going on this weekend. It's kind of crazy. It's because the weather's perfect and everyone times it. Yeah. Right. So that's why we're recording today, is because tomorrow we're going to go to the Halloween parade.
Yeah.
And the reason we didn't plan anything else is because we actually have a lot of work to do. We have a huge deliverable next week.
So much work to do.
And we'll be traveling next week back to New York. So that's, I think the big focus is
Connecticut.
Yeah. Same thing. So that's why we're being good.
We're being good.
Yeah.
I'm proud of us.
Yeah. So we are going to go to the Halloween parade tomorrow with the kids.
Yeah. Maybe.
That's Alex and Caitlin.
Oh, and then tonight I can say this on this because we're not posting this until Monday.
Yeah.
So I won't be ruining a surprise.
Happy birthday, Connie.
Happy birthday, Connie.
Yeah.
So our dear friend. She's literally one of the nicest people you'll ever meet.
She sent me soup whenever I crashed my bike.
Not just soup, but it was like this care package of like...
Yeah, fancy soup.
Fancy soup with like a ladle. I mean, it was so cute. I want to do that for someone because that was such a good little care package.
Yeah.
I can't remember. I'm trying to think. I can't remember the brand that...
It's funny, when I broke my hip, I had so many people send me food. But this time... It was only Connie sent me food. I guess the difference is you. I was alone last time.
Yeah, yeah. People felt bad for you.
Yeah. John Traynor had to come over to the house just to make sure I was check my pulse.
Yeah, so now I'm here.
Okay. That's why. Anyway, it's a surprise party for Connie tonight at Double Zero. We're really excited because we've never been.
Yeah. Pizza place, wine place.
Castellucci Group.
Yes. Castellucci. We rode by, or we drove by the other day on our way to Emory for that, the showing for Joanna.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I really want to go there. So it works out perfectly.
Castellucci Group for everyone is Iberian Pig, Double Zero, Cooks and Soldiers. Mm-hmm. It is a family group, and it's two brothers and a sister, Stephanie, that we know. She's
the
really,
nicest
really,
people.
Yeah. And they just, I think Stephanie might move to Nashville because they just opened a restaurant in Nashville.
Yeah. And I think she just got married.
So shout out to Stephanie. Congrats.
So nice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we're checking out Double Zero tonight.
Yeah. That's pretty much it with the personal stuff this week.
Yeah.
Lots
of work going on.
Yeah. We, from a work perspective, we're so busy to where I actually had a call with a potential client last week. And I just was like, we actually can't take on any more work this year.
Yeah, we have pushing things in the next
year. So much work that, yeah, it's just a little overwhelming. But it kind of, it's always a little bit like this towards the end of the year.
Every year.
And we're thankful for it because we really like to be busy. But we do have some big projects coming up.
We're thankful for all our corporate clients that like to wait till Q4 to get all the goals in.
Some bonus time.
Yeah. Hey, we know the game.
I think there's a few things that Chad and I had interesting conversations throughout the week with our team, with each other.
Well, because we're so busy, we're talking to our team about how we can be more efficient.
How we can be more productive.
Yeah.
Get things done quicker. And with creatives, with creative team, that can be difficult sometimes because...
Yeah, they don't like that conversation.
Well, as a creative myself, you want everything to be perfect. And so you spend a lot of time... whether it's design, whether it's copyright, you just really want to take as much time as possible to make it as perfect as possible if you're, you know, if you really care about what you're doing.
We had a client yesterday tell us, because they've like expedited this timeline, I don't know if you caught this, she basically was like, it doesn't have to be perfect. We just And you and I kind of like cringe. We're like, we can't not do it perfect. So I guess we'll just work all night.
Yeah. It's not in our... like, it's not the way we do things. It has to be. But we're going against what we're saying right now. Because what we're saying is that we're trying to get our team to be more efficient with their time.
Right.
And so knowing that our team is a bunch of perfectionists, how do we take things out of their day that takes time, that doesn't really contribute to that perfectionism? And a lot of that is you can use AI to do it.
Yeah.
And so... we were talking to, you know, one of our best creatives, and we asked, you know, like, have you used AI to kind of help with some of the copywriting stuff just to like generate different ideas? And so you're not spending so much time in like writer's block. And really the answer was basically, no, I've been hesitant to use that tool. And I completely understand that because I also was.
You're all hesitant to use it.
Yeah. Well, because it feels like cheating.
It's not though. So I am a heavy user of AI, and we're going to integrate AI into our agency work more and more. I think it's a value add. I think it is a way to not only, it's not about the productivity for me. I think it's more about sparking new ideas. If you can get really good at prompting, which I've spent basically this entire year doing. And so it can also summarize notes, which I think is amazing.
That's been a huge help.
Yes. And I mean, if you think about what we do, we're interviewing hundreds, if not thousands of people over the course of a year.
Mm-hmm.
And just going back and writing out your notes takes so much time. I've been using AI to effectively generate notes for me based on those conversations I'm having. It's pretty, really, really cool.
Do you want to say what you use? Because there's a bunch of tools out there and we've tested them, but pretty much only one stands out.
Yeah, Otter AI is a transcribing tool that you can use on your desktop or your phone. And it basically transcribes every word perfectly. And then at the end, it's like, here are the main topics. Here's what was said. Here's who said it. You can prompt it just like you can with ChatGPT. So you can prompt it and say, okay, what was the most important thing that this person, that Nikki identified as, that stood out to her about culture? And it'll give you the five things that Nikki said.
And so it's spot on.
It's spot on. It's, well, I mean, really I've good. Tested it. I've gone back. I've done it to myself, like just like me acting like I'm interviewing myself. It's incredibly efficient, and it allows you to get to the creative process more quickly, I think.
That and what I've been using it for, and maybe this is like, it's a personal thing for me, but when I'm writing something, my biggest struggle is making things shorter. I tend to be more of like a descriptive, longer-winded writer, just like I am when I talk. And knowing that that's my weakness, what I've started doing is running things through AI, like that I write and say, can you make this more succinct? Can you make this shorter? And then obviously I'll go back and tweak and make sure that it's perfect. But it really does a great job pulling out what you're trying, the point you're trying to get across, and just making it a little bit shorter, a little bit cleaner. I did this for not a client, but I volunteer. I'm on like the board of this organization, and I help with different copywriting, graphic design, social media, whatever. And I didn't have a lot of time. So one of the women sent me this like long description of basically what they wanted to post on social media. But it was so long that if you had posted this, you wouldn't be able to on Twitter and people wouldn't read it.
It'd be have to be like a thread.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so I just ran it through. I ran it through AI and said, can you rewrite this for Twitter? And can you rewrite this for the most effective way to catch people's eye on LinkedIn and Facebook? Mm-hmm. And it just did it. And I had to regenerate the Twitter one a couple times to like get like the best possible version. But again, I just didn't have time in my day to sit down and get distracted by this. So I just ran it through AI and it saved me a lot of time.
Yeah. So I think that the summary here is that a lot of our creative team are resistant. I think a lot of creatives in general are resistant to it because they're worried that it's going to take their job. And one of the things that we believe is that it's not going to take your job as a copywriter or as a creative or as a graphic designer, as long as you know how to use the tool. I think is the skill, mm-hmm. right? And so people don't understand what the tool is and they don't know how to use it. They're going to get left behind completely.
So what will take your job is a copywriter or a graphic designer who uses AI, who knows how to use AI.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So it's not the actual tool taking your job. It's someone just more versed and skilled in the new way of operating that will take your job. And that's kind of like anything in the world.
They're going to be faster. They're going to have more ideas. They're going to have more options. Yeah. You're going to get left behind.
Well, think about like when cars were being made by hand. As soon as they started bringing in machinery that they were able to mass produce cars, the people that were not capable of learn or didn't want to learn how to operate the manufacturing facilities got left behind. It wasn't the machine that replaced them. It was the lack of motivation to learn something new. And so more people come in, they learn something new, and they replace you.
We have a client right now that is literally disrupting security services mm-hmm. by utilizing technology, because old school security services.
I hate the word disrupting.
I know you hate disrupting.
Disrupt.
Nikki used to work for a startup that was their
every call.
Was that your purpose?
We are disrupting.
Right. But they weren't, but it was vaporware.
But they weren't disrupting anything.
Anyway, but they're like, it's the exact same thing. Like using technology to just be better is the smart thing to do instead of sticking your head in the sand.
Yeah, agreed.
So all you creatives out there, get on it.
Yeah, just learn. Always be learning.
Yeah.
That's what I say.
So the other work thing I think you wanted to talk about was...
Yeah, this is kind of like a personal... I felt like it needed to be said because I've recently been seeing it more and more. And also I've been experiencing it myself. And I'll explain what that is. So
you've been asked by several of our clients that are executives about this topic.
Correct.
Within the last 6 months, you've had multiple people asking you about this topic.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I think so what I've been asked is there's been a surge in women in the workplace walking into their boss's office or their boss's boss or whoever it is. And essentially kind of laying out demands around, I deserve more money, I deserve a raise, I deserve XYZ. And while I'm a huge advocate for advocating for yourself, I don't think you should just sit by and like let everyone else, you know, around you get promoted and not speak up. I think the problem is that social media and business coaches and life coaches and all these people who we've been constantly inundated with.
TikTok coaches.
More so because of TikTok since the pandemic. It's causing women to not go about asking for things in the right way when it comes to the workplace. And so I say that because you can't just go into an executive's office and sit there and say, I deserve this job. It's not fair. Blah, 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 blah. I've been here for 5 years and I've put the time in, and so therefore I deserve it. And if you don't give it to me, I'm gonna stomp my feet. And you know, when we were talking about this, because I was like, where is this coming from? I truly believe that it is the TikTok Instagram culture of women coaching other women, which I am in support of if you have experience in the thing that you're coaching on. But there's a lot of,
like, have you actually worked in a Fortune 500?
But there's
company?
A lot of, yeah, women out there on TikTok who, and maybe there's men out there too. I don't know. I don't land on the side of male coaching on TikTok and Twitter and Instagram. So it's not my purview.
Me either.
But there's a lot of women out there who, when you look at their LinkedIn, when you look at their bio, they have zero experience in anything other than talking at TikTok. And they're saying, you need to demand more. You need to do this. You need to stand up for yourself. And it's,
know your worth.
Know your worth.
Yeah.
Know your worth.
I've seen that.
And it's very frustrating because you're giving young women really bad advice. And it's significantly impacting their future because they're not strategically thinking about how to have these productive conversations around compensation and raises. And
the bad advice is to be confrontational, effectively.
Yeah. Yeah, the bad advice, yeah, is like, you go in there and you stomp your hand, you know, hand on the table, and you demand what you want, where you want, when you want it. And like, reality check, that's not the way life works. Mm-hmm. That very, very rarely, unless maybe you're in like a sales organization where I've seen salespeople obviously act more aggressively towards each other when it comes to demanding compensation.
Yeah, that's
sometimes,
like,
but that's like on a different island.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you are just in a, like,
so you don't think guys do this?
I think guys are more tactful. Based on what I've seen,
yeah.
I'm not theorizing this with no experience. I believe that men, for whatever reason, I don't know what advice they're getting, must be better. I don't know. And not every man, but I think the way a man goes about going into an office of their boss, I don't think they're emotionally slamming their hand down on the desk saying, I deserve a raise because I said so.
Yeah.
Because Susie Q on TikTok told me that I deserve it.
I've had a lot of people work for me over my career, and I can't remember one man ever doing that. Now that you say that.
But I bet there weren't a lot of women that did that either. I think it's a generational thing.
Yeah.
It's 100% a Gen Z / younger millennial situation that's going on because of social media.
I actually had one guy, now that I think about it. There was one guy, and he was in technology. But he was I agree. I think when I was working,
did you give him a raise?
No.
So what we should be talking to each other about is if we're going to preach something, it should be coming from experience. And so if we're going to get on TikTok, it should be a gestalt way of sharing an experience that you went through that worked or didn't work, and saying, you know what, younger people, younger women, when I wanted a raise, when I wanted, you know, a promotion that I felt like I deserved, this is how I went about it. Tactfully, I was playing the long game. This is what I was thinking about long term, because I think for me, I'm not going to just march into an executive's office and say I deserve a raise. I might say, hey, executive, if they're this type of personality, if they're, you know, more of a servant leader, can I get like 30 minutes in the lunchroom with you? Or, you know, can I get 30 minutes coffee with you in the break room? I really want to hear how you came up through this organization. Mm-hmm. And so it's more of a conversation around learning about how you can get to that certain point versus demanding to be at that point when you think you should be at that point. Because no matter what TikTok person says to you, they have zero control over your future.
Yeah, they don't care.
They don't care.
But my advice is always, it's the same as Linda Matzigeit's advice, right? Put me in coach.
Yeah.
Not in the back of the plane, but put me in the game, right? And I think what the way I articulate it is, and what I did was, I was always willing to take on more responsibility.
Yeah, teach yourself.
And that's what gets people's attention in a corporate environment. Someone that's willing to take on more responsibility and perform at the highest level and outwork other people are the people that get promotions and the people that get raises.
Exactly.
9 times out of 10. Not all the time, because there are some people that get promotions and raises and it's a head scratcher. But if the tried and true method is that, take on more, do more work than you're being paid for, work harder and work better.
And I think
people will notice.
And I think people would say, well, I don't want to do more work and not be paid for it. But like, okay, well, there's other people doing more work and not being paid for it. So it's a race, people. Like
my whole life,
the people who train on the weekends and don't train during the week, they never finish before the people who train all week long and on the weekends. That's exactly. just the fact of life.
Exactly.
So, you know, take it for what it is. But ladies, please stop listening to these TikTok idiots that have no experience. They sit in their home, in their apartment all day, just preaching at a screen, giving you life advice that could potentially cause you to lose your job because you are not facilitating relationships and communicating in the way that normal people facilitate relationships and communicate, because you're going based off what some chick on TikTok told you to do.
Yeah, it's crazy.
So I am preaching.
Yeah, you
because
are.
I have seen really bad ramifications for women that I think are really smart.
Yeah.
But they made some poor business decisions.
Yeah.
Based on what they had, how they had been influenced by a book or a podcast or a TikToker.
Don't listen to that podcast. Listen to this podcast.
Yeah. So off that topic, it's dangerous to take advice from idiots. That's my motto.
Yeah.
So know who you're listening
to.
That
was in her notes.
That was in my notes.
Okay. So we've got to go check the results of the Big Sugar Gravel Race because Michael Garrison, future guest of the pod, is racing currently as we speak. And he's there with the BMC crew. Hopefully he's having a good race. He flatted a lot last year, so I'm worried about flatting. And so we're going to actually talk to Michael soon on the podcast about his plans for next year, which are really exciting. We've been working behind the scenes on that.
Yeah, we've got a lot of exciting news coming.
Yes, a lot of exciting news about our team. Yep. And
the future of the team, what we're doing.
Exactly.
And we have a really big 2024 goal that will potentially change the trajectory of the team, the business, everything. It's been a long time coming, but
wow. Wow.
I'm putting it out there to the universe because we've been dragging our feet on this one.
Yep.
And I think it has to happen. 2024 is going to be a big year.
Yep.
Ready.
All right. So with that, I think we're good.
That's it. Well, let's go.
Have
walk
a great
the dog.
Week, everyone. And thanks again for everyone for the feedback, the reposting, the sharing. Keep doing that, you know, especially all of our friends in Miami and New York and LA and San Diego. We thank you so much for supporting us. And then all of our international friends, especially our folks in Melbourne, still haven't heard from you. we're very interested still. Everyone like,
follow, subscribe. Although right. I still don't know how to rate. On Apple. So let's look that up real quick. To rate on Apple, because so on Spotify, you rate it, you go to the channel.
Yeah, the main page.
The main page.
Yeah.
And it's at the top, like stars. Obviously, yeah. You click 5 stars, duh. But with Apple, you actually have to scroll all the way to the bottom past the episodes to
really?
Rate it. Yeah, see, it's all the way at the bottom.
Wow, it's terrible.
We are 5 stars on Apple.
Mm. I just gave us 5 stars.
I just gave us 5 stars too.
Oh, you Ooh. Can write a review too.
So that's how you rate on Apple.
Oh, and by the way, if you have noticed that I sound a little bit different, it's because I'm back on the fancy microphone, our Rode NT1. We both have Rode NT1s, thanks to our friends at Rode. We also have Rode pod mics. And so I've been on the pod mics the last few episodes because I thought my NT1 was broken. It wasn't broken. Do you want to say what it was?
You just had it turned the wrong way.
It was facing the wrong direction. So Rode,
like, this thing sucks.
Rode, thank you for having on your social media. Make sure the gold dot faces you when you talk on a Rode NT1.
I was facing Michael the wrong. Michael will think this is hilarious because he always thinks that your issues with technology is human error, and you always argue with him that it's not.
Yeah, this time it was.
He might be right.
Yeah. All right. So all right. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.